The sun goes through an 11-year cycle of increased and decreased activity. At the peak of each solar cycle, the sun's magnetic field changes polarity as its inner magnetic dynamo reorganizes itself. Last solar maximum was in April 2014, and the next solar maximum expected around 2025. So the question is, how can solar activity affect us on Earth? Solar winds are continuous flow of charged particles that normally stream from the sun. Solar flares are intense bursts of radiation, and some of the energy they release can reach Earth relatively quickly, in less than 10 minutes, if our planet is in its path. And CMEs, or the coronal mass ejections, are much larger eruptions that hurl clouds of magnetized plasma far into the space and can reach Earth within 3 days. Well, for normal people like you and me, this is just a piece of news on the 11th page, except occasional loss of signal on our dish TV. But the astronauts on the International Space Station needs to be extra careful or they will get lethal dose of radiation. And if you're a tech giant like Elon Musk, then you want to delay your launch of new sets of Starlink satellites, or they might just burn and fall off from space. Big bursts of CMEs can potentially burn power grids and affect radio signals and communication system used by airlines and many government agencies. These CMEs can also affect our satellite positioning system and GPS navigation capabilities. So yes, it can cause some serious troubles, but then we do have eyes in the sky. I mean, we are constantly observing sun and monitoring the space weather. And most of the time, we get a fair warning of our incoming inconveniences. Now, as we all know that Earth's magnetic field deflects most of the assault from the sun, but some does find their way via poles into Earth's atmosphere. Most of the time, this results into beautiful aurora at polar region, but they cause quite a bit of nuisance in satellite positioning that are vital for flying an aircraft or doing an offshore survey. These charged particles don't just hang around the polar region, they escape to the tropics and they form a band of highly ionized particle between tropics of Cancer and tropics of Capricorn. These charged particles normally stay between mesosphere and thermosphere, that is about 60 km to about 300 km from surface. They collide with molecules and atoms and knocks electrons free and creating electrically charged ions and free electrons. These charged regions are called ionosphere. So these regions affect the GPS signals in two ways, refraction and diffraction. Both type of effects originate in the group delay and phase advance that a GPS signal experiences as it interacts with the free electrons along its transmission path. Number of free electrons is known as TEC, or total electron content, in 1 square meter cross section. The product of group velocity and phase velocity of the GPS signals is equal to the speed of light squared. So if the TEC, or the total electron content, increases, the group velocity slows down and the phase velocity speeds up to keep their product at constant. A slower group velocity produces ranging errors, while faster phase velocity causes unexpected phase shifts. The second effect, signal diffraction, is a bit more complicated. When ionospheric irregularities form at scale lengths of about 400 meters, they begin to scatter GPS signals. So the radio wave reaches the receiver through multiple paths. The GPS signals on each path will add in a phase-wise sense, causing fluctuations in the signal amplitude and phase. Too much physics, I know. Please bear with me for a few more seconds. So decades of studying satellite signals, including GPS signals, we have a clear picture of ionosphere and how they behave. So we created an ionospheric model to mitigate that problem. But various intensities of solar storms, CME events during solar maximum can very easily throw our predicted ionospheric model out of window. The greatest danger to satellite signal is at tropical latitudes, where ionospheric storms typically form after sunset and last for several hours. The heavy ionosphere supported by horizontal magnetic field lines can suddenly erupt with bubbles hundreds of kilometers across that violently surge upward at many hundred meters per second, leaving behind an ionosphere filled with irregularities. Okay, enough physics. In simple terms, this is called scintillation. And this is a space-based multipath that makes GPS positioning very difficult. In the tropics or mid-latitudes, this can form severe outage of GPS signals, and unfortunately, we know very little about this problem. Because during the last solar maximum, very few resources were applied to understanding scintillations at mid-latitudes. This phenomenon of GPS signal outage at mid-latitude during intense solar storm can last for days, and most of the time they're occurring between particular time period, mostly 3 to 4 hours between dusk till dawn. So when you are offshore doing some critical work, keep an eye on the news of solar storm. I have some reference materials in the description that you can use. Remember, knowledge is power, and never stop learning.